the last 15 years or so. Bruce got his PhD in history here at Tulane prior to that.
Is it open on Saturdays?
It's open Saturday morning. I'm pretty sure that's true all year round. I'll need to check to make sure in the summer that.
We'll look up the hours here. Okay. The hours.
Oh, great. Thank you.
What else? Big, well, two things. One is I'm feeling a little bit in the groove now that we got our start yesterday. And one of the things I really enjoyed about yesterday is the level of discussion going on, both during the seminar and in our breaks when you come up to me. So by all means, keep that coming. Don't be shy. At all, both while I'm talking and when you see me lurking out and about, just flag me down. And in fact, I think I'm going to try to go over to the curriculum meeting today just to check that out and make sure that what we're talking about in here is translating into what you're going to need to take away with you. Okay? So, as a specific example of that, one student, Stefan, mentioned that the reading for Bruce's talk didn't make it into the reader. It was the first three chapters of a great book by Thomas Brothers, which is called Louis Armstrong's New Orleans. And I'm pretty sure.
It's on Bruce's bibliography sheet that he gives.
Okay. I'm pretty sure I know what happened is that it was three chapters of a book, and so my question to Andrea at Gilder Lehrman was, can we copyright-wise distribute three chapters from a book? It's, I don't know how these things work, and I have a feeling that thread got lost.
It's a little bit of a gray area.
Yeah.
We work with a company that clears all of the copyrights for us, and sometimes they will just say, it'll just be a no, and they don't always tell us.
Mm-hmm.
It might have been a little bit tricky, though. I think that's probably what happened.
Either that happened, or it's even possible that our email communication about all the files I was sending her, that was one small part of it that might have got lost in communication. I'm not sure, but I didn't follow up on it. And now, that's unfortunate because it's a great reading for bringing together what we're talking about, which is all of the elements that stream into informed jazz here in New Orleans. So if I recommend the whole book. It's an amazing, it's the best introduction to New Orleans jazz, and it's done through Louis Armstrong as sort of a prism, not really like a day-to-day biography of his life, but a much more thematic, very rich discussion of New Orleans at the time of his youth, which was from 1900 or 1901. To when he left in 1921, which is basically when jazz is consolidating here. So check it out. I'm sorry you don't have that information in your heads as you heard Bruce's talk, and as I pick up my talk today. It'll probably help me, though, kind of make sure we're covering our bases. I'd already decided that for this lecture right now.
Which one are you talking about? I'm sorry. Which, can you say the name of that book again?
Thomas Brothers.
Okay, thank you.
Louis Armstrong's New Orleans. For right now, you read an article by Lawrence Levine, the Dean of American Studies scholars, especially as it relates to African American and culture. And he wrote a book, by the way, called Highbrow, Lowbrow, which is very famous. And this chapter, thank you very much, Lawrence Levine, is like a distillation of the music idea that he puts forward in that book. So you don't actually need to read that book if you read the article for today and you're mostly interested in music. But what I'd already decided to do was to kind of presume that the idea that Lawrence Levine puts forward in that book is sort of in your head, and we don't need to cover it so much as use it as a foundation to talk about some styles of music that also came into New Orleans and across the country to inform the emergence of jazz, which we think is around, say, 1900 to 1915 or so, when all this activity is going on. And so I want to use the idea that Levine puts forward, which is basically that at the time when America is trying to figure out its own culture under the shadow of European elitism, which we were founded, that jazz is this very disruptive art form, right? That basically is considered scandalous and that people are fascinated and repulsed by. And what I want to do is kind of mention that, which I just did, and sprinkle that throughout today's talk, but I really want to make sure we know about blues and ragtime and some of the other forms that were coming into New Orleans when no one would have recognized the word jazz in, say, 1900 or 1890 or 1910, and try to be a little bit more meticulous about these forms of music, especially now that I'm aware that you don't have the sort of brothers' history of jazz through Louis Armstrong under your belt. So everyone okay with that? Any questions before we get started on that? Jake mentioned to me that he uses this site very often, NEA Jazz in the School, so I just left it up on my screen if you want to write down that address. I'm pretty sure that that is the result of what Bruce was saying. He had prepared his talk, remember, for Gerald Early. I'm pretty sure this is the website resource that came out of that scholarly meeting in the late 90s and early 2000s. So take that away and get back to my PowerPoint. While I'm thinking of it, the other question we had was, can I share the PowerPoint presentations? So is that something I can talk about with Gilder Lehrman afterwards about how a large file can be shared with the group? And I have Bruce's PowerPoint presentation as well. Okay. That was a long introduction. That was a 10-minute introduction. Okay. I'm going to draw again my circle. I talked about circulation yesterday, this idea that musical elements, both in terms of practice and agency and actions that we talked about, and then discussion about those musical elements, like the George Washington Cable article, or the Bambula writing, or the Gottschalk sheet music that gets disseminated, all kind of swirl around together and sort of mutually inform the developing understandings of what something is. So if jazz, we were talking about the circulations that inform the emergence of jazz. You know, another metaphor for this would be this whole like rhizome model that people that talk about. It comes out of French philosophy of Gilles Deleuze, this idea that we're not marching together in some sort of forward progressive motion where history is linear like that, but it's just this constant, more chaotic threads that are entangled together at any given point. And deciding on something like jazz is like trying to, you know, look at part of the threads that are coming together. So what are some of those threads that we've talked about so far? For instance, yesterday I lectured for a while on spirituals, and there's a whole great chapter in the Brothers about Louis Armstrong's early experiences with black religious music and the Baptist and sanctified churches. Something we wouldn't have called gospel yet, by the way, until the 1930s. I'll get to that later in class. But that, you know, think of that in your head, right? So that's one ingredient. What are some other ingredients we've mentioned so far that would sort of inform musical styles that would inform the emergence of jazz, as Bruce talked about, around 1900?
Brass bands.
This practice of marching with acoustic instruments that are mobile, right, that comes out of the military traditions. They appear in all the colonies all throughout the New World, right, and imported from Europe, along with armies, right? You know, these are military marching bands. Very rigorous, very, in terms of the rhythms, obviously it's meant to give you a tempo to march with and very structured in terms of formation. In terms of uniforms as well, traditionally Prussian military uniforms. But in New Orleans and in a few other colonies, that tradition really became kind of localized and rooted as a very black tradition in New Orleans with its own local cultural traditions, the jazz funeral and the second line prayer. Those are keep coming up, and they'll kind of culminate on Friday with a lecture performance by the Hadi brass band group of young men who I work with in my research. That's going to be. I should just stop talking now and just take over. Okay, brass bands, what else?
Instruments,
like just more generally?
I would say brass, trumpet, drums, but you could just say instruments because you can use any type of instrument in jazz. Any type, but percussion.
Mm-hmm. An instrument, I try to teach people to think of an instrument as a tool. It doesn't have any association, I mean it has associations,
musical
but it doesn't have any limit to it. It's entirely up to the performer how they express themselves through an instrument. So for example, there's a raging debate that goes on today in New Orleans about should we teach young people how to play jazz or should we just teach them how to play the fundamentals of music, the technique of how to use their horn, and then they can use those basics to fundamentals to go out and make whatever kind of music they want, jazz, brass band, etc. I'm a big proponent of that school, which is puts me in, for once in my life, in a slightly Eurocentric camp, and I did go to conservatory and all that. But an instrument doesn't have a kind of musical affiliation. So that's what I'm looking for here. For example, instruments beyond the brass and the percussion that we would have heard in marching bands would have been in the ballroom dance bands that were huge in New Orleans. There were at one point 80 to 100 halls where ballroom dancing would have taken place in New Orleans from about the early, say like 1820 to 1920 or so. At any given point, there's 100 places you can go in New Orleans to dance to a quadrille or a waltz. And those European dance fashions updated every 10 years or so and became closer and closer in terms of couples dancing, right? Because prior to that, it was much more about group dancing, right, and not as intimate. And more over time, it becomes about these intimate couples dances, and we get closer and closer to two-steps and foxtrots, and then it's the scandalous cakewalk and ragtime and all of that, right? And we get up to jazz. Those were huge in New Orleans, and as far as instruments go, strings, and other
so
instruments.
So you're looking for more general terms in relation to jazz?
Styles.
Styles.
Yep.
Blues, ragtime.
Okay. These are the two we're going to talk about today, so thank you.
What's African?
For bringing that up. Let's bracket blues and ragtime because we'll spend an hour talking about that.
African?
Okay. African drumming or African ritual in terms of what happened at Congo Square, which doesn't directly inform jazz because we know there's a big gap between when the Congo Square dances end in 1845 and when we think jazz emerges about 50 or 60 years later. But we know that because of the musical practices that we can associate with the ring shout, that would probably be a better term to use here, that those musical elements persisted, right?
Would you consider more
something like ballroom dance would have been both white and Creole, and to a lesser extent, African-American, right? Spirituals would have been almost entirely African-American. Brass bands would have been all by 1900 or so. Blues would have been almost entirely African-American. Ragtime is middle and upper class African-American, not from New Orleans. And obviously African ritual is African-American. What
American
we're going to hear about later today, what's that?
Improvisation?
The American culture, good.
No, that's okay. Improvisation would have informed brass band music by 1900, blues by 1900. Actually, not ragtime. Ragtime is composed. Obviously, the ring shout and spirituals, and not ballroom dance, which would have been composed and read faithfully.
Folk Eurocentric music.
French
opera.
Yeah.
What about the classic, what about that classical element we discussed this morning at the Opera House?
Opera, the problematic term, coverall term, might be serious music, right? I love making fun of that term, and my older colleagues still use it in this. Yes, these were, for instance, there was a Negro Philharmonic Society in New Orleans in 1840. There were, which is a fascinating check. You know, New Orleans is such a fascinating place, and as I mentioned yesterday, and I should stress again, the opera houses and classical concert venues were often open to Creoles and to free people of color, and on Sunday to slaves. And then after the Reconstruction, this is where, and I had a question today about, it gets difficult to keep track of changes over time, especially when we're running through so much information. But after Reconstruction, things get more segregated. This is very hard for us in our progressive minds to understand, but New Orleans is a freer, liberal, more accepting place of racial sort of interaction prior to the Civil War, and then in this brief window of Reconstruction, say 1867, 1877, we're at the vanguard of the nation for the struggle over the rights of blacks. And I use that term because it would include both Creoles and African Americans. Clampdown, 1877, Southern Redeemers wipe all blacks out of state legislature, instantly enact the first round of Jim Crow laws, and it's like overnight, Creoles and blacks stripped of their power and their rights, and things get much harsher from that period on. And one of the things we're going to talk today is that coincides with a huge influx of freed slaves from the rural plantations coming to New Orleans first, long before the Great Northern Migration to Chicago is a great urban migration to places like New Orleans, Atlanta, Houston, which are literally dots on the map. No one knows what Atlanta is in 1890, right? Or even something like Miami or Houston, right? These are places that by the middle of the 20th century are far larger than New Orleans. But in the period we're talking about, New Orleans is the largest southern city, right? I know this is a lot of information, but I'm trying to use this window today to kind of bring together some of the disparate elements we've been talking about. One segment.
So are we saying African American spirituals are synonymous with black church music at the time? And if so, what's going on with white church music? Is there like a white church music culture in the world?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
And does that inform what's going on in jazz?
No. I'll say no just because, geez, I gotta draw a line
somewhere. I just don't have any concept of what's going on in the white church at that time.
At that time, first of all, I'm probably not the right person to ask. Second of all, I think it's just as diverse as the black church.
Yeah.
For instance, are any of you familiar with the white Pentecostal tradition? You know, this is a fire and brimstone, totally ecstatic, very, very musical form of worship. That is very, I mean, this is where, say, you know, Think in your mind Jerry Lee Lewis at the piano. When I think of that, I think of like roots in the white Pentecostal church. He, I think, actually attended the church that Brother Claude Ely, this amazing white Pentecostal singer and guitarist, ran a church. And there were churches like that all over Louisiana. My impression of that, not having studied this very clearly, is that those white Pentecostal churches were heavily influenced by black Baptist and sanctified churches.
A little integrated.
They were integrated at certain times.
They're certainly way more integrated than any other Protestant tradition.
Sure. Yes. That's true. But those are also the parishioners that I would say in wide swath terms became Southern Dixiecrats, right? The white working class Southerners. Is that fair?
I don't have enough information to agree or dispute it, but it Pentecostals, I think, in general would be, especially at that time, would be more or less apolitical. You know, could a Dixiecrat have made and they also tend, Pentecostals historically tend not to have lifelong affiliations. It tends to be an affiliation that you have transitionally. It might not be something that you pass on, father. You might not stay in it your entire life like you would traditionally, let's say, in a Baptist church, Methodist church, Catholic church. So could a Dixiecrat have made had a pass through a Pentecostal or Holiness church? Sure, but I would see that it tend to be more apolitical. I mean, they just, we are not going to be of this world, and that means, you know, we're not going to drink or smoke or get involved in politics. Mm-hmm. You know, whereas Baptist or Methodist tradition would be far more political.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think the short answer, you know, and obviously that New Orleans is a very Catholic city, and we don't normally associate the Catholic Church at this time as a place where that's a particularly musical mass, right? Even in black Catholic churches in New Orleans, which there are several. Now, there's one black Catholic church in New Orleans now, St. Augustine, that saying that in contemporary times is a very musical service, and Rome doesn't like it at all. They took away the preacher there. Right?
Do we want to include the vernacular that you talked about this morning in that?
Well, I would say one. Okay. I don't want to get into vernacular. Vernacular is a term I break with my colleagues. I don't really particularly like using that term. But blues, spirituals, this is what, and the black brass band tradition is the coverall term for what he's talking about. Vernacular is, of course, a metaphor based on local language dialects, right? This idea that at the everyday ground level, say something like Ebonics that was brought up earlier, I can't remember how, is in New Orleans has a particular way of manifesting, and that term, scientific term for that in terms of language, is vernacular, and then it gets applied as a metaphor for cultural everyday. Politics to me is like,
when you talk about history and talk about how when the changes in the legislature and after Reconstruction and how it just overtook the inclusion of race and culture in New Orleans. So with politics, or I'm trying to think of a good term that would fit that concept, because all of this changes after 1870. So that deals with politics. So how would you fit that in?
Okay, I'm glad you brought this up. Let me add one more musical style that we're gonna hear about later today, which is Latin American. New Orleans was a port, very active port, the largest port in America, and then after New York takes that title away in the late 1800s, it's still the largest port in the South for years until Galveston, Miami take over. And the port traffic here is mostly, we're propping up the banana republics if you're into your world history. United Fruit Company based here in New Orleans, who funded the Stone Center for Latin American Studies at Tulane. Students were all shocked to learn.
But recently? Stone. Recently funded, or?
Well, yeah. I mean, he's the benefit. It's called the Stone Center of Latin American Studies. He owned United Fruit Company. And I have to be very careful. So that's important. So back to, it's Tia or Tia?
Tia?
Tia. Back to Tia's question about politics, because I'm glad you brought this up, and it seems, obviously it doesn't inform here. Here's what, this to me is what the politics is it's the container, right? And so I'm glad you brought this up because we've had all kinds of references to Plessy versus Ferguson. I think Bruce mentioned it a little bit, but is this something you I should talk about, spend a minute in class
yeah.
to talk
yes.
about?
We all
because I feel like it's a great way to bring New Orleans race, as you're talking about, in politics. It kind of smacks it all together. It's a pet fascination of mine, although, again, I'm not a historian. But Plessy versus Ferguson is the case that starts in 1892 in New Orleans when Omer Plessy boards a segregated train car and is arrested, and the case goes to the regional court and then the state court, and then it goes all the way to the Supreme Court. And it basically winds up deciding, making Jim Crow law, right? Which is separate but equal, the Supreme Court decides in 1896. And eventually the determination over that is what we pejoratively call the one drop rule, right? This rule that if you have a drop of black blood, that you are biologically black and you are subject to the rules of segregation, especially in public accommodations like train cars, like lunch counters, all the things that are gonna come up in the 50s when this is ultimately overturned with Brown versus Board of Education, right? Wow, that was about the fastest. The interesting thing about Plessy versus Ferguson, which, I did this shorthand version of it, because I'm sure a lot of you are very familiar with it already, is that it has to start here in New Orleans. We have to have somebody like an Omer Plessy who doesn't identify as African American, he identifies as Creole. He calls himself an octoroon, which is what we think of as a pejorative term, which literally means 1/8 Negro blood, right? As opposed, like a quadroon is 1/4 Negro blood. But he literally this whole thing is planned by the predecessor institution to the NAACP by Creole lawyers in New Orleans who see an opportunity to challenge the law. How is the Supreme Court going to tell this man who looks white, is middle class, and who has to identify himself to the train conductor as being a black person in the white car in order to get arrested? How is the Supreme Court going to decide where in separate but equal is Omer Plessy gonna go? Well, that's a very New Orleans story because only in New Orleans is this Creole in-between population first of all, proud of its heritage, right? And where say, in one county over, we would be talking about miscegenation, right? We would be talking about, say, like a Strom Thurmond history of erasing sex between blacks and whites, right? And we are talking about sex, right? I think I get challenged a lot about this. It's like, well, why are we talking about sex when we're talking about, Creolization? Well, black and white people had sex together, and there's no metaphor here. And why are we talking about hybridity? Well, hybridity is like a whole metaphorical language thing.
Breeding cattle.
Right. We're talking about, biology. People, getting together.
And that's also the terms in which you use to try and control, to retain segregation, is fears of...
Right.
Fears of...
Fears of miscegenation, which becomes common in New Orleans as well after, again, when this clampdown in the 1870s forth. So that Omer versus Plessy is a really... Plessy versus Ferguson is a really interesting window into New Orleans at the time, the political climate from which jazz emerged. And what I'm sort of arguing in my article that you read for yesterday to get back to Tia's question is, we can't, these ingredients we now know all somehow inform jazz, but racially they don't all line up in terms of being black music. But why is jazz considered black music? Well, obviously, primarily because the most innovative features of it come from African ritual and African American American versions of spirituals and blues. To explain it, to me, Plessy versus Ferguson actually helps explain it. When you tell a mongrel mixed race populace that you've got to choose one or the other, and of course you can't choose to be white if you're visibly black, and so there are occasional examples of people passe blanc, right, of passing as white, but as a minority or a residue of this larger picture. This larger picture is like one or the other, right? America is a biracial society, and never more so at this time is it divided along those lines. And so jazz, to me, as a cultural form, becomes black music in part because the political racial climate of the time says these things cannot be mixed. They must be categorized as one or the other.
So it's not white music, it's got to be...
Right. Well, and it's clearly not white music. All of the salient characteristics of it are black. But what happened to me that's really sort of painful in retrospect is that all the scholarship for decades and decades simply propped up this idea. So we have book after book talking about jazz as an African-American art form, which is absolutely true, but it actually takes something away from the ingenuity of the African Americans who played it, who might have gone to hear an opera, or who might have gone to play, who knew how to play a quadrille like Buddy Bolden did at a ballroom dance, or dressed in a marching band uniform and could read music and were musically literate, right? Over and over again we hear about the New Orleans natural musician, like, as if it bubbles up from the streets, but actually it takes a lot of talent and technique and practice. I tell my kids, you know, all the time, you know, Trombone Shorty, who's a great young musician in New Orleans, you know, if you took away his musical education and his drive and determination, he's just another guy on the block, right? What separates him at 23 or 24 as a touring national musician and an innovator is the fact that he worked so hard at all of assimilating whatever he wanted to do, right?
And then here's the flip side. Why do we consider jazz as just being black music when you have Latin music, mm-hmm. which is a combination of a lot of these ingredients?
Right.
So then there's politics behind it as being labeled as black music when it's not really black music. But on the flip side, why would we label it black music when you have a Latin music, which is a combination of the same thing?
Right. And I think that the answer to that we can all get with is that the ingenuity in jazz clearly derived from the ability to take the instruments and musical forms and repertoire and melodies from, say, anywhere, European, Latin America, whatever, and apply this real African aesthetic to them. Improvisation, participation, social dance music, funky rhythms, et cetera, right? Those are the characteristics that we're going to talk about today. When white people first hear it, they're like, you know, I'm feeling things I'm not exactly sure to put up, have out on the table. Yeah, we have two questions here.
I was just curious about the Italians and Sicilians in this story, because yesterday it came up briefly on the tour, the lynching of the 11 or 12 mm-hmm. Italians. Mm-hmm. And I think my students would be really interested in hearing and understanding that dynamic of, because there's a lot of stuff in the northern cities about when the Irish became white, or when,
right.
when immigrant populations assimilated into white culture.
Right.
Can you talk maybe just a little bit about
sure.
that story? Or
sure,
the
I mean,
Italian
we had
experience?
This question earlier as well during the break, and a couple things. In terms of New Orleans has waves of immigration. And the first are the Germans, then the Irish in the mid-19th century. And this is common in urban areas everywhere. And then Jews and Italians at the end of the 19th century and into the 20th century. And then, you know, Vietnamese in the 1970s for obvious reasons. But that's out of our purview. What is interesting about each of those groups in terms of teaching what in the last sort of 20 years has consolidated around whiteness studies, especially in terms of ethnicity. And I try to be, you know, precise about calling ethnicity ethnicity and race race, because race is often a word that people are scared to use. Is that each of these immigrants, as we all know, went through a period where they were at the bottom of the American totem pole, and they were basically considered by Blue Blood America to be non-white, right? And so it's hard for our students, especially, and even for some of us, to understand that when the Irish arrive, and you know, in the whole, what's the Five Corners movie and book?
Gangs
of New York, right? That whole, you know, have that in your head, right? This idea that the Irish are the new working class, sort of, not indentured servants, but exchangeable labor, right? Expendable labor, I guess is the term we should use. Of the, what is that, 1840s to 60s, right, or so. The Italians were absolutely that in, say, the 1880s to the 1910s. And so what happens is they're not considered fully white. And the lynching that, so the reason why Italians come to Louisiana is because rural plantations have lost their slave labor in droves. And they actually start going to places in Europe that are experiencing great famine and recruiting workers. And this happens all over the Caribbean. This is why my people, Syrians, are in Jamaica and Trinidad. You know, this is why the whole Southeast Asian population that's in Trinidad and stuff as well, right? And why Italians and Irish pop up in weird places like South Louisiana and the Caribbean as well. The huge example is Argentina, right, where a huge percentage of the population came over from Italy. So though that was because of a big famine that was happening in Italy, they set up a shipping line directly from Palermo to New Orleans, and a bunch of people came over. They went out to the rural plantations, just like the plantation owners told them, and they quickly realized that was not the place for them to be, making large amounts of money. And over a decade or so, they almost universally moved to New Orleans, took over the French market, took over the produce trade. Of course, there's a lot of rumor and undoubtedly fact of mafia connections. And when the police chief is killed, 12 Italians in 1890, 12 Italians are blamed. When they're acquitted, the White League storms the jail and hangs these 11, I think it's 11 actually, Italians, right, in 1890. And by the way, when I was studying this as a student, even places like the New York Times applauded the White League. So this was not a Southern racism thing. This was a moment in U.S. history when remember what's going on scientifically at the time is eugenics, right? Where scientists are trying to prove things like, well, Africans are intellectually hampered because their craniums are smaller, right? They're literally like, this is where, you know, NIH of the days are pouring their resources, right? And that, of course, gets used as for anti-conservative, anti-immigration policies to keep away Albanians or Italians or whoever the next round of immigrants are coming in, right? So Italians were playing jazz music in New Orleans, but more than anything, they were running the underground economy that jazz was in, the bars, the corner grocery stores, and the whorehouses, right? Bruce Rayburn has an article on Italians and Jews and jazz that I'm going to add to our handout.
It's not his bibliography, he's got it on his
okay. And also, I think on there is the book by Donald Marquis that's the biography of Buddy Bolden. That book has some really neat maps in there that I love where they show the bars that Buddy Bolden played in and list their owners, and it's just Italian name after Italian name all throughout there. So So eventually, by 1936, New Orleans elects an Italian mayor, Mike Maestri, to office. So, and by the 1950s and 60s, Italians are part of the white flight out of New Orleans during the Civil Rights era. It's a classic, you know, assimilation narrative in terms of ethnic U.S. history, and that's how it played out here because it coincided with the emergence of jazz. And obviously, one other thing is that Bruce mentioned that these tended to be Sicilians, and Sicilians are the sort of dark, swarthy Italians in terms of like the way Italians perceive of themselves, right? Yeah.
From the hatred for Italians being like New Orleans a little more personal than it was everywhere else. Like it was kind of generalized in America, the Catholic, I mean, right there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I always explain to the kids we had one president who's Catholic and we shot him. So it's like, you know, because being from here, it's really hard for the kids to realize that they're the
right
minority in the country.
Mm-hmm.
But here it got personal because of the economics. You know, like, I don't know. I would say that it was more favorable in the big cities because they went into police forces and things like that because it was really hard to get into those underground economy spots because they're all sewn up. But here, you know, it's like they were introducing a new way of doing it and that hadn't been thought of. So it's a little more personal here. And that's why you see the, you know, the murder and lynching and things like that, which I know there were other, you know, examples of all over the country, but, you know.
Yeah, not a lot, though, but I think you're right. And I also, your point also makes me realize, I didn't mention that Italian food became integrated into New Orleans food in a way a lot of people don't, a lot of people who live here have no idea, right? And so when you go to Mandina's or Liuza's or these real old-line New Orleans joints, yes, they have fried seafood, but they also always have spaghetti and meatballs and Italian sausage po' boys, and which are delicious. So, okay, now that became a 45-minute introduction. But that's okay, that's exactly the kind of discussion I wanted to have to try to tie up these threads together, especially as you think about how you're going to process this information and pass it along or make it your own. So I want to talk about two of the styles that were on my messy map that we've talked about a fair amount, but we haven't really kind of focused on them. Blues and ragtime, and then Dan Sharp's going to come later today and talk about Latin American music. And then by tomorrow, we'll be moving on into jazz as a national music and the styles that developed out of that. So, I want to talk a little bit about the blues, which I don't think we've devoted, kind of given its due, right? Is that right? What's so interesting about the blues is that it became identified with the rural South and the plantations of the rural South before and after slavery. And researchers believed that in these enclaves, and you know, think of a plantation economy as very different from a New Orleans type slave and post-slave system, where obviously we're talking about concentrated groups of people on a plantation, like Dockery is a very famous one outside of Clarksdale, Mississippi. And then, you know, nothing for a while, right? And then other little towns and little plantations. That in these enclaves, slaves and their the first generation of post-slave African Americans had limited contact with whites, and it was projected that because of that, this was the purest African American music. And what we're talking about here in terms of what would ultimately be sort of classified as blues, or at least the roots of blues music, we're especially talking about what workers did during and after work, which is field hollers, work songs, and kind of social dance music for entertainment, which took various forms, right? Field hollers are essentially solo singing to pass the time away at work. I'm not going to play one in class today, but I can tip you off to a great audio example. I'll put that.
By Alan Lomax.
Yeah. Tangle Eye Blues. Work songs are a little bit more interesting in terms of this class because they demonstrate a lot of the musical characteristics that we've talked about as being so salient in this form. It's teams of collective labor that are maintaining a shared rhythm, right? So here's a Lomax recording from 1934. This is my first audio of the day. So once again, this is anthropologically interesting because Alan Lomax and his dad John decided to go into the state penitentiary where they're from, in Huntsville, Texas, where Lead Belly, the great blues musician, they would come later, actually before this, serve some time, and record the prisoners who were obviously in forced labor, right? So what did we hear on this in terms of what we talked about yesterday in terms of musical characteristics?
Call
and response, very clearly. The foreman, won't you ring that hammer ring, is the response, right? And the call changes every time as the foreman calls out, and the response stays the same. What else was interesting about this music? The steady beat, right? And the work song is a great example of the functionality of rhythm, right? Why does we all need to be on the same beat. We need to synchronize our labor, right? Especially when you think about something like lining track. In fact, I can tell you one thing that rhythm tells us about this example. See, I lost my hand.
Did they do a live recording and then as they were working they just recorded the music as well as the, because I'm thinking the railroad track,
right?
They're plowing the,
right? It's too fast.
Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
I heard this.
Yeah.
I'm like, there's no way
like
in a real work situation because to hammer that fast.
No, it almost sounds like.
Are they tapping?
Yeah.
Are they tapping something?
So this is how one track would be lined, right? It's two guys with sledgehammers, but I still say that's way too fast.
When he went into Fritz Lomax, they kind of gathered them into a room with
sure.
a recording.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so they would.
No, it's got to be straight out of some Coen Brothers movie where there's a white watch and she's like, boys, come on over here. That's how I picture it. I have no evidence or proof, never read anything about it, but I'm quite sure that's exactly how it happened. But they also recorded prisoners lining the track, and the point to take away is there. Of course, we don't know the circumstances that these recordings came about, but they obviously have some basis in reality, right? Team labor, rhythm, call and response. It's all participatory music that serves a function of bringing people into some kind of synchronization, right? Yeah.
I just had a quick question, and this might be too specific, but. The correlation between the use of vibrato, the voice,
mm-hmm.
and then vibrato that may have been taking place in instruments at the time in New Orleans.
That's a great question. I don't know what to say about that exactly, except that New Orleans musicians were celebrated for two aspects. One was to play a melody on their horn very straight, in other words, without a lot of embellishment, and to play their horns that in a way that mimicked the singing of the human voice, which included vibrato, and even imitations that later became called freak music, where manipulating the trumpet or something, making it sound like a baby crying, or adding a plunger mute to make it sound like a wah-wah type of sound. So I know that doesn't answer your question. I'm not exactly sure if I can. And I also...
Bendy goats would be, bendy goats as well.
What's that?
And you make a wah-wah sound, but also it's kind of like that you're bending notes that way.
Well, we're going to get to that in terms of blues has many elements to it that we call blues. Blues is one of those terms that has multiple meanings, right? And so I think I can answer that in terms of blues is, on the one hand, a musical form. In other words, there's a song form. It lasts 12 bars long. It's called 12-bar blues. And we can talk, I've got a few examples of that we can talk about. When musicians say, let's play a blues, that's what they mean. That a song progresses with certain sections, and that section in a blues is a 12-bar repeating phrase, right? We'll get to that in 1 second if you're confused. Another aspect that we call the blues is the manipulation of pitch, right? These in-between notes that we keep referring to as blue and sometimes as blue notes, which basically means with the human voice or with an instrument where you can manipulate the pitch. In other words, on something like a piano, you can't because it's set, right? But on almost any stringed instrument and all wind instruments, you can bend the pitch, right? That is considered a very blues thing. And so maybe you do need to hear Tangle Eye if I have it on here. And there's specific pitches that are associated with the blues, and I can't get into this in this large class, especially with limited time, because it's very, very difficult to explain to the non-musicians. But basically, within the pitches of a scale, the third and seventh degrees of the scale are lowered, what musicians call flat. And those become called blue notes. So that's another manipulation of pitch that happens. In other words, when we hear something blues, so for instance, when we're hanging hammering, we're hearing it from our musicians, we're hearing root, flat, third, and that's the relationship that's called the blue note, right? If I can do Tangle Eye, do I have that on? Here's another recording.
That third one.
Right? And also the bends. Those kinds of in-between notes. You can't play what he's doing on a piano. You have to replicate it with a slide.
Well, I wonder will I ever get back?
So that all of those things feature under blues in terms of manipulation of pitch, 12-bar blues, and then of course, what we all know is the blues is an emotive state, right? Where the blues becomes a metaphor. Let me get to the blues as a form of music, and then we can elaborate on what I just talked about a little bit. Hopefully it'll kind of settle in. The development of the blues parallels and is entangled with jazz, and that's why we're talking about it. So let me talk about the blues as a genre of music. And that's something we most associate with instrumentation, solo guitar, and voice, and later the possibility of piano, right? But often small instrumentation, and often one musician who accompanies him or herself on guitar, right? And the most, the place where that style of music became identified with is, of course, the Mississippi Delta, right? in below Memphis, near Clarksdale, Mississippi. And but frankly, this that instrumentation and that style of music, yes, was common in Texas. It was common in the Piedmont. It was common in New Orleans too, as well, much less common than other styles of music. It appeared everywhere, but researchers actually sort of decided that it was the Mississippi Delta that really had this unique and plentiful approach to the blues. And the first, and oldest musician who recorded by the mid-1920s was Charlie Patton, who learned to play on the Dockery Plantation outside of Clarksdale. Let me see if I can go there. Back to this. All right. Got one more shot. This is his Pony Blues from 1920. Which was done in the Midwest, actually, in 29, you know, Charlie Patton traveled from the Mississippi Delta to make the recording. He also recorded religious music, so this, just FYI, from the same session, beautiful, amazing recording called Prayer of Death. On this tune in particular, you can really hear him bending the notes both with his voice, and he's playing slide guitar. Slide guitar is where you put a bottleneck or some type of round device on your finger, and that allows you to play in between the notes, right? He's almost doing a call and response with himself, right? Between his voice and his instrument. See, I lost the thing.
Go to the slide before and then go back. Is this recording?
So that end was obviously a call and response conversation between him and the guitar, and if you've got a musical ear, those were those blue notes that I was discussing earlier. That shows a lot of things embedded in that example, sacred and secular. I mean, he's recording these songs in the same session, right? Pony Blues, obviously, this very suggestive metaphorical song. And I also love the call and response in there. It's a great example of the style of music that we now call blues, right? But even in the 1920s, the musicians playing this music wouldn't have necessarily known how to categorize it in that way. Rural, southern style, very guitar-based and driven style, and piano to a lesser extent, right? Something that didn't appear too much in New Orleans, though Lonnie Johnson and a few other blues musicians did grow up here. But I want to talk about how the blues came in to the New Orleans style in a few ways.
I just want to mention another aesthetic to that is kind of the freeness of the form.
Mm-hmm. The most celebrated Delta blues musician was Robert Johnson for a couple of reasons. One, he came late into the field. He didn't record until 1938, so he's a little bit younger than the Charlie Pattons and Son Houses that he learned from. He was able to pick up their best licks and songs, and also he had his ear was very attuned to recordings. We've been able musicologically to figure out that he heard music recordings of musicians from Chicago or whatever and copped their licks, to use the term that musicians use, right? And so he was a very, the famous legend about him is that he was an average musician who went to the crossroads and sold his soul to the devil and came back a great musician. What historians actually believed is that, what's that?
I was thinking, sorry, wasn't there a movie, that phrase you just said, that was in the line of
Crossroads, yeah. Okay. Yeah. From the 80s when I was a kid.
Joni Mitchell wrote a song, like a tribute to him. I don't know if you've heard that. Sold My Soul,
it's an old Irish legend.
It's an old legend, period. Historians are basically like, yeah, we're pretty sure he went away and practiced his ass off. And there's a great book by Elijah Wald called Escaping the Blues. You're going to read a little chapter. And he pretty meticulously goes through how Robert Johnson was able to assimilate so much and make these amazing songs. But I want to play one of his songs as a way to teach the 12-bar blues Ben is talking about a little bit, as a organization of a song form. But is there a hand up for?
I was just going to say, when we went through Memphis, I decided I was going to track that place down, and it's in a bad area. It's a really bad area. Uh-huh. So yeah, I can't imagine anybody going out there at midnight. I'm sure it was much different then, but yeah, we decided to just abandon that adventure for today.
All right, let's listen to, I'll dust my broom, Robert Johnson, and I'm going to talk over it to try to draw your attention to the song structure. And when musicians say form, it's a synonym for structure, how songs are written. Right? A little introduction, and then if we were to count the beats, we would go,
I'm gonna get
one,
up in the morning.
Three, four, two. Played music with before, and we could say, let's do a 12-bar blues in E, and we could play together in front of 1,000 people without ever meeting each other before that, right? Because we know where this song is going, right? And we know that we can sing a lyric over those 12 bar blues, we could take a solo over 12 bars, and then every 12 bars it's gonna come up again, right? So, and I know this is confusing with the lyrics, but separate from the lyrics when we talk about the form of a 12 bar blues is A repeated, right? With each of these A's being this 12 bar long series of chord progressions, right? Most pop music in terms of form is what we call binary. There's an alternation between one section and another section, and often the A is what we call the verse, and the B is what we call some kind of chorus or refrain, right? Which if you think of any song that's going on the radio right now, it's usually alternating between these two sections, and then at some point, Maceo will take me to the bridge. or what the British, like the Beatles, call the middle eight, right? Some C section to continue my discussion more. So I just wanted to put that out there because the blues is really interesting in this way where it means a lot of different things. It means certain notes in the scale, it means the ability to bend pitch, or the that is some type of method, and it means like the organization of, or the structure of music.
I just wanted to throw out there too, if people are interested in teaching this, if you just do a Google search for PBS Blues,
right.
There's really very concise articles and introduction to the 12 Bar Blues.
Right, and I think this song is the example they use to show you, to teach you how to learn 12-bar blues. I use that for my kids, and I'll add that.
I think it's easy if you showed it on the guitar, because even I don't really, that's not really my instrument, but even I learned the.
I didn't bring my guitar today, right? But I could do that. How did this inform New Orleans music very quickly? So that I can spend a few minutes on ragtime before we break. New Orleans is not particularly a guitar town. Bugs me too, trust me. But we don't have a tradition of solo singing blues guitarists, right? There's a few, I always get the hand, what about Snook Siegel and what about Lonnie Johnson? Absolutely, they're here. It's not like we don't have that kind of classic blues setup in New Orleans, but it's not what people think about when they think about New Orleans music writ large. We think about horns and drums and pianos, right? And so the great comment that's in the Thomas Brothers book, that from the trumpeter Hippolyte Charles, who was an early jazz musician, is we didn't sing the blues, we played the blues. This is a really interesting kind of condensation about how the blues came to New Orleans, right? And it's also a sort of history lesson connecting us back up to what we talked about before, which was that after the Civil War, between 1865 and 1900, 40,000 African Americans moved to New Orleans. Huge number, right? For the vast majority of them are freed slaves from the rural plantations, 40,000. And so, over that 40-year span. And so, the character of New Orleans changes. New Orleans is already a city where free people of color, African Americans, and Creoles have a very visible and high presence, but this influx of the freed slaves adds to that and complicates it. And in fact, there's divisions between these newcomers and Creoles, right? And other old line identity differences, right? But we're pretty sure that it was this influx of rural former plantation slaves that bring these blues and very ecstatic spirituals into the city, or at least really maximize their audibility, right? And so by the time Louis Armstrong is 13 years old, which would have been 1914, his first job first music job is to play at a bar where, which sort of doubles as a bordello, right? Very, very low class bar run by an Italian in Louis Armstrong's neighborhood, which was right by City Hall and was leveled. That was Black Storyville, right? The Black Prostitution District. His friend's name's Cocaine Buddy. I have no idea what he did, but that was the name Louis Armstrong remembers him by. The quote Louis Armstrong writes in his amazing autobiography, which is called Satchmo, My Life in New Orleans, which he took me like 2 or 3 hours to read. It's a page-turner. All you have to do is put on your long pants and play the blues for the whores that hustle all night. That was his advice. You're going on your first music job. I'm lining up this music job for you. Just play the blues all night and no one's going to complain. You know, they'll all be into it. That slow and low music with the bluesy manipulations of the melody, that real gut bucket country sound, it was perfected or most identifiable when Armstrong teamed up with his mentor, King Oliver. We can really hear the integratedness of blues and jazz on the recordings they made together in Chicago in 1923. This was when Oliver, who was already up in Chicago, he left in 1918 or 1919 to start a jazz dance night. I'm pretty sure it was at Lincoln Gardens. And he called for Louis Armstrong, his disciple, in 1921. And Armstrong took a train from New Orleans to Chicago and never moved back. And became a star based out of his association with Oliver in Chicago in a band that Oliver called his King Oliver's Creole Jazz Band. Let's just listen to this whole recording, and I'll talk over a little bit of Dippermouth Blues, their most famous recording from 1923. And we can hear, first I'll point out the 12-bar blues form, and then we can same chord progression through the whole song with different musical arrangements happening over it. So, you know, you can imagine the conversation before the recording session goes something like this, you know. Oh, here's the head, you know. Then, you know, clarinet, you take a solo. We'll all solo together. Then I'm going to take a solo until the needle runs out, and then we'll play a final out chorus and the claim that's being made is that when somebody says, play that thing, well, that was improvised at the time. It doesn't sound like it to me, but really a lot of activity going on under this consistent baseline of the 12 bar blues.
There should also be an example with utilization of the woodblock instead of the drum.
Right, right. In the early recording period, the engineers couldn't accommodate the loudness of the drum set, so that the drummers were instructed to use their sticks on a wood block because it was softer.
So who's playing the piano?
What's that? That's Louis Armstrong's wife, Lil Hardin Armstrong. But they were only married for a few years, but she was the piano player in this band and a composer and piano player and singer. In her own right, though, jazz history has sort of rewritten her only as Armstrong's ex.
Speaking of women, was Ma Rainey, was this around the same time?
This was exactly around the same time as Ma Rainey.
She was from New Orleans, was she?
Mahalia Jackson was from New Orleans. Ma Rainey was not.
Okay.
We're going to talk about classic blues women tomorrow afternoon, so I'm glad you brought that up. So we heard very distinctly how blues and blues-associated musical elements came into New Orleans, and we have a pretty clear explanation that it probably had something to do with all of these rural African Americans moving into New Orleans at the time when blues music was developing and when jazz was developing. And so we can also see how if you were a marching band at the time, you might start playing 12-bar blues on your parades, or you might start using those bluesy manipulations of pitch in your solos and in your melody writing and that kind of stuff, right? All those things that we flag as blues. And we don't know if it's because it came from the rural to the urban or if it was all in the air at the same time, but historically, it seems to make a lot of sense that these things were integrated and happening coterminously. Yeah.
It seems as though I've been in situations, I've heard at various seminars and things on a more like a district level, someone will say among music educators that there's this pattern of work songs, spirituals, kind of simultaneously developing, and then that gave way to the blues and then jazz.
Mm-hmm.
That is not accurate. Is that true?
Well,
are you saying that blues kind of developed along with
early
jazz?
Yes,
prior to
I mean, historically, absolutely they did, but I would say no blues, no jazz. You can't have jazz without blues. So in that sense, the dominant narrative is true. It's just that there's nothing historically on record as like a 12-bar blues, or certainly anything recorded until at least 1913 or so. And by then we know jazz is happening as well.
Because
so,
a lot of the traditional 12-bar blues for non-musicians. Later it was adopted, and I attest to this as well, what's called a jazz blues among a lot of guys that play,
mm-hmm.
which is very different in the construction of the chord, the overall chord structure of the song.
Right.
The form is the same, but the chord structure changes because of 2-5-1, for example,
yeah.
Which has to do with the type of chord they use. So that's kind of why I'm asking.
Yeah. And there's 8-bar blues, and there's 16-bar blues, and there's all kinds of variations. And we don't know. We're not able to talk about them in terms of exact chronology.
Okay.
But
I just forgot to ask you.
Yeah.
Here, so.
Thanks. I'm serious. I want to talk for 1 minute about ragtime because it really helps us understand what Levine was trying to get across in his essay, which is why, what is it about these African American forms of music that were so scandalous and then ultimately so attractive to white listeners? In your handouts that I gave you yesterday is this contemporary account. It's actually a letter to the editor from a white listener who in paragraph number 5 here, I'll just read it out loud, says,
yes, that's what you gave us.
Right, I just want to make sure I get the right paragraph. Is it 4 or 5? Paragraph 5, okay. There's a certain sway and swing, a certain indescribable, sensuous something, appealing and suggestive about the ring and melody of rhythm and versification of this music. He's talking about ragtime as it's becoming a national craze in the early 1900s. Scrutinizingly criticized, every one of the songs is insidiously perverting. They are indicative of relaxative morality, of disparagement of the marital tie, of triviality in relationship of sex, etc., and the entire moral code might be included. There is not even an attempt made at concealment of the thought conveyed in the song. It is out and out vulgarity. Right? This is the music he's talking about. This is the music.
Please,
he's talking
disgusting.
About.
Please,
right?
Please.
I know you're running away in droves. So, in my very limited time, where's the disconnect between what we hear as a, actually, and what actually was a very well apportioned and composed musical form? What is it that Walter, what's his name?
Walter Winston Kenilworth.
Yes, love it. He's saying, I love this. He's like, I listen to every single ragtime composition twice. My wife can attest that I lose complete control of my emotions. I have to take cold showers every time I do.
What's the year in this letter? Oh,
1913. So what is the disconnect? What was he hearing that has been so acclimated to our ears? A little bit about ragtime to kind of prop up the argument against Walter, who's our poor straw man here. Classical ragtime comes out of Missouri in the late 1800s, of all places. St. Louis especially, but really Sedalia, Missouri, a big hub. Scott Joplin, James Scott, Joseph Lamb, all African-American composers of ragtime. And when I say composers, it's because this was primarily instrumental music that was written out on sheet music, which is, of course, prior to recording, and that's how it was disseminated, and that's what Walter would have heard. In other words, he would have been talking about maybe his daughter or somebody in his family purchasing ragtime sheet music and playing it on the piano at a party. And the question is, what is he hearing that is so scandalizing to him in a song like I played for you, which was Maple Leaf Rag, the most famous rag, rag obviously being the noun for an example of ragtime, and written in 1899.
Does he know the author or the composer of the music before he makes judgment? We don't know.
I don't know.
So maybe it's his suppressed sexual issue.
Hell yeah. but we can try to be more systematic about it.
Okay.
What is taking away at his suppression, right? There's two things that he actually points out. I think, okay, this is why I was confused. Because in the paragraph before, he says, let's see. Oh, no, that's not it.
The last sentence?
Negro music more modernly adapted.
Yeah, they want to help. So he knows the. He knows the
indescribable. Okay. No, it is the same paragraph. So,
but the one before it, he knows the place where the music comes from. So then he talks about it in the negative tone where it comes from, and then he describes it as being vulgar.
Here it is. Okay. It bears radical resemblance to the fantastic waywardness of Creole song. It is a modulated derivation. What is he talking about there? From a musicological perspective, I would say he's talking about blue notes. He's talking about there's something going on in the harmony that's modulated derivation or wayward, right? What he's saying is, I can't figure out if it's major or minor or happy or sad. I don't know where to put it in my classical music box, and that's disconcerting, right? And then he goes to the far more evident aspect to our ears of this music at the time, that about in terms of its rhythm, right, the indescribable sensual something, the modular derivation, the fantastic waywardness of Creole song, and the incessant driving pulse and syncopation, right? So what he's talking about there is what we were talking about in terms of polyrhythm and syncopation, which was the aspect of ragtime that, one, made it so disconcerting to a conservative ears, and so alluring to others. This was the time when ragtime and cakewalk, especially around the 1893 Columbian Exposition in Chicago, where ragtime really has its coming out party, and then by, say, 1899, 1900, ragtime is the number one seller in terms of genres of sheet music, right? So this is the period we're talking about here, pre-jazz, right around the same time as blues, but this very educated, composed music that borrows little elements like rhythmic syncopation and blue notes and even Latin American rhythms into these, and much more directly into an elite world where home entertainment includes playing popular songs at the piano, right? And so, I'm rushing here, but I want to get to two things. One is that this is what Lawrence Levine is talking about. I think this is from page 7 or 8 of the reading for today. Culture was the product of that side of ourselves that craved order, stability, definition. This is him talking about.
We can read it for
them. Which page was it again?
Read it to us off your screen.
It was the expression of a colonial side of ourselves that we have not done nearly enough to understand. I am convinced that we would know ourselves better if we understood our past more firmly as the history of a people who attained political and economic independence long before we attained cultural independence. So what he's saying is, when colonial America becomes the United States of America, we cut our independence from Europe, but in terms of the dominant view of what American culture was, it was essentially European for a long, long, long time, until things like ragtime and jazz come along and start chipping away at this Eurocentric idea of what American culture is and starts replacing it with this popular culture idea that we all, by 2012, can recognize. To go on, culturally we remain, to a much larger extent than we have yet recognized, a colonized people attempting to define itself in the shadow of a former imperial power, obviously Britain. Jazz was an expression of that other side of ourselves that strove to recognize the positive aspects of our newness and our heterogeneity, that learned to be comfortable with the fact that a significant part of our heritage derived from Africa and other non-European sources, and that recognized in the various syncretized cultures that became so characteristic of the United States, not an embarrassing weakness, but a dynamic source of strength. So in other words, he's saying ragtime, blues, jazz, these were challenges to the idea of what it meant to be an American or what American culture was. Oh, look, this thing came up.
Thank you.
Of course, that won't work. So what's this? This is the 1974 film version of the great 1920s novel.
Yeah. Mr. Gatsby would be honored if you would attend his little party tonight.
F. Scott Fitzgerald writing about the elite New Yorkers who are in their summer home on Long Island, right? This is the jazz age, right? And so what Lawrence Levine is saying, and I realize I'm jumping ahead in terms of ragtime and the blues and into jazz, is that by the 1920s, were able to have a broad embrace and acceptance of jazz as entertainment, right? And so we'll have figures like you know, these jazz parties, right? We have the concerts by white jazz orchestras in the elite halls of New York, like Carnegie Hall. The most famous first of these was led by the aptly named director Paul Whiteman, who debuted at Aeolian Hall with his jazz orchestra in 1924. Among the music he played there was George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, right? Gershwin, born Jacob Gershovitz in Brooklyn to Ukrainian Jews, cut his teeth in Tin Pan Alley, which is basically West, is it 56th or 57th Street in New York, right? The Brill Building and other buildings where composers just churned out popular song. In Gershwin's day, in the teens and 20s, that meant taking black jazz and turning it into a white American popular song, right? And Gershwin, as a composer, then went a step further and started writing jazz symphonies. Rhapsody in Blue is essentially like a jazz piano concerto. Porgy and Bess, a jazz opera, right, that he adapted from DuBose Hayward's novel about Catfish Row in Charleston, right? So this concertizing, we're ending right now today with this, the first inklings of the sort of acceptance and elevation of this black music by the white public. And we zoomed pretty quickly, but we're gonna come back over this material, that 20s to 30s, 40s transition tomorrow. And we're going to keep this conversation going with the focus on Latin America in an hour, right? Is that right? So any questions before we break? Or feel free, I'll join you.